Hello, welcome to part one of the talk, the deformation space of non-orientable hyperbolic three manifolds. In part one, we will study the orientable case and see the results that are from the 80s on the topic. The goal of this part is to study a neighborhood of hyperbolic structures on a given three manifold and parameterize it. Some idea on how to do this parametrization and to compute these deformations. Well, I would say the deformation space is this neighborhood of hyperbolic structures. And some idea on how to compute it comes from the Teichmuller space. So if we consider the Fensch-Nielsen coordinates of the Teichmuller space, for instance, we consider the pair of bands, the composition of the closed surface or genus 2. This is given by two pair of bands. And these again can be constructed from each of them from two hexagons. Now, the Teichmuller space is the set of hyperbolic structures on the manifold, on the surface. And in order to obtain these structures, we have to consider these hexagons inside of F2. So some way to obtain new structures on said surface, different metrics on it, is just to change the parameters on the hexagons. For instance, if this is related to the loop in the middle, we can consider a longer side and the new hexagons and glue them back together again. And geometrically, this would look like something like this. Okay, we will have a bigger middle loop and the rest more or less the same. So something more or less like this. How many parameters do we have here? Well, we have three positive real numbers, one for each loop in the pair of band decomposition, but there are another three here which correspond when we glue back together the pair of bands, we can make a twist. So for instance, here we could twist along this geodesic and obtain the other parameters in total. So this corresponds to twist and the other ones to lengths. The takeaway from this example is that to obtain representation, it's very useful to cut the manifold in smaller pieces and deform the pieces and glue them back together. And this is precisely what Thurston did in the 80s to the figure-eight knot complement. The complement of this knot is a hyperbolic three manifold, and Thurston showed in the 80s that it admits a triangulation using two ideal tetrahedra. That means that the tetrahedra have no vertices. And as we are computing hyperbolic structures, these tetrahedra are inside hyperbolic three space. They are the deformations of each of them is parameterized by one complex number. And when we try to glue them back together, they have to satisfy some compatibility condition, which in this case is this equation here. Well, this is a Z equal to one. And the solution to this equation corresponds to the deformation space, the complement of the knot. And he proved that this is an open set in C. In general, our goal in this part is to show how to prove the general theorem for this, which is that if we, in the version of links, we consider the complement of a link in S3, this is biholomorphic to an open set inside of C2BL, where L is the number of components of the link. This theorem is by Thurston. Thurston and Neumann-Zagier. Okay. We will consider here this kind of manifolds connected, complete, hyperbolic, three manifolds of finite volume. Hyperbolic means that it's Riemannian and it has a sectional curvature constant and equal to minus one, but this is equivalent to it being locally isometric to the hyperbolic three space. And the hyperbolic three space can be seen as the upper half space in R3. R3 with the following metric. At a point ZT, it's 1 over T squared times the Euclidean metric. And with this metric, it is the, well, as I said, the upper half space. And geodesics are section of circumferences which are orthogonal to C times zero, which is not in hyperbolic three space, or vertical lines, which are orthogonal to infinity. So they are basically circumferences which are orthogonal to what's known as the boundary at infinity, which is the set C times zero union infinity point, which is homomorphic to the Riemann sphere. The boundary at infinity plays a very important role in the theory. For instance, the isometric group of the hyperbolic three space acts on it, and the isometries are completely determined by their action on the boundary at infinity. So this allows us to prove that the isometric group the orientation preserving isometries is isomorphic to PSL to C, and they correspond to their action in the boundary corresponds to fractional linear transformation. And on the other hand, the orientation reversing isometries corresponds to transformation in the form, this form. Plus D. Okay. Some examples of isometries. We have dilations. So Z goes to KZ in the boundary at infinity, and they extend in an obvious way to the whole space. They leave the axis from the geodesic from zero to infinity invariant, and they act as a dilation in the whole space. We also have rotations. So again, they extend in an obvious way. They extend as a rotation with axis the geodesic from zero to infinity. And we also have translation as an example. Okay, in order to extend this, we consider horizontal planes and repeat the same translation. Okay, horizontal planes and different heights. These horizontal planes are examples of all spheres of hyperbolic three space. And finally, as an example of a non-orientable isometry, we have the complex conjugation, which extends as a reflection on this hyperplane, which is the vertical hyperplane. Okay, now we know how hyperbolic three space looks like. Let's look like at the pieces that we will use to construct our manifolds. These are the ideal tetrahedra, And an ideal tetrahedron is just a tetrahedron inside of the hyperbolic three space, well, a geodesic tetrahedron, having the vertices in the boundary at infinity. And in order to visualize them, it's useful to consider one of the vertices in at infinity. We can always do this by applying an orientation preserving isometry. And then they have this appearance here. They look like this, this kind of tower. And as we said at the beginning, we are using them because, first of all, they have finite volume, and we are parameterized. Well, we will use it to parameterize the deformation of space of manifolds with finite volume. And on the other hand, they can be parameterized by just one complex parameter, as we will see next. In order to parameterize them, what we do is apply another orientation on preserving isometry and to move the vertices to 0, 1, infinity, and the third one with positive imaginary part. This fourth vertex here parameterizes the tetrahedron. And if this is the edge, this is called this Z of E, the edge invariant of E. And it parameterizes the tetrahedron. So we have, for each tetrahedron, we have six edges invariants, but they are related as follows. So if we have opposite edges, then the opposite edges have the same edge invariant. And on the other hand, if we have three edges in this cyclic order, three edges, they are related by the formula Z of E2 is the edge invariant of E1. Well, sorry, it's 1/1 minus the edge invariant of E1, where and Z of E3 is the edge invariant of E1 over the edge invariant of E1 minus 1. So as we see here, we would only need one edge parameter. However, I prefer to use the three of them. And recall that opposite edges have the same parameter. These are called the tetrahedron relations. And now, as I stated at the beginning, now we know how to deform the tetrahedra just by considering new parameters satisfying the tetrahedron relations. And if we have a manifold, we will consider manifolds which are ideally triangulated, that is, they have a triangulation by ideal tetrahedra with the faces viewed by isometries. It is an open question if every manifold satisfies this with our hypothesis. Virtually, there was a paper in the archive that says that it states that virtually every set manifold does. But the general case, it's still open. But there are many, many examples of this. And now the thing is that we can always deform them as long as they deform the tetrahedra as they satisfy the tetrahedron relations. And we can always glue them back. However, they don't always give rise to a new hyperbolic structure. There is a condition to be satisfied, which happens as at the edges, at the one skeleton. So we consider an edge cycle, that is several edges that are glued by the isometries. And if we realize the tetrahedra around this edge cycle, we have something like this. We start with the first tetrahedra. This is the edge cycle E. Okay. Then we glue the next tetrahedra to that face in the back. And we have something like this. And we go on with this process. We glue the next one here, and we have something like this, and so on. And The manifold will have a hyperbolic structure if the, this gluing closes up. And in terms of the edge invariance, we can always assume that this has vertices 0, infinity, 1, and the edge invariant of E1. Then the next tetrahedral have vertices, well, these vertices set of E2, and we have to multiply by the previous vertex, of E1, and the next one has vertices set of E3 times the previous vertices, set of E2, set of E1, and so on. So the relation they must satisfy in terms of the edge invariant is that the product is equal to 1, and the sum of the arguments is equal to 2 pi. These are called the compatibility equations. And this must be satisfied for any edge cycle. And then we have the our obvious definition. Well, the the obvious definition of the deformation space. The deformation space of the manifold with respect to the triangulation, delta is the triangulation, is an open set of parameters. Recall that we use 3 parameters for each tetrahedron, such that they satisfy the tetrahedron relations and the compatibility equations. And this open set here that we take is a neighborhood of the complete structure that we denote like this with a supernode. And this is by Mostow, well, this is the complete structure. And this is by Mostow and Prasad rigidity theorem unique. So every other deformation will be a non-complete, well, will give rise to a non-complete metric. Nick by Mostow and Prasad. Okay, so there's a problem with this definition. It is that it depends on the triangulation. So we need to find some intrinsic way to parameterize it. And moreover, we cannot see here the dimension of the deformation space is. So it depends on the triangulation. Okay. And in order to see how to parameterize it intrinsically, we have to consider the finite volume of the manifold. And there is a theorem in hyperbolic geometry that states that a complete hyperbolic free manifold has finite volume if and only if it's the interior of a compact three manifold with boundary, and the boundary of this three manifold is a disjoint union of tori and a disjoint union of Klein bottles. And these tori and Klein bottles are called respectively the peripheral torus, well, tori and the peripheral Klein bottles. In the case of this part of the talk, we won't consider Klein bottles as the manifolds we are considering are orientable. And where can we see this peripheral tori? Well, in the example I put at the beginning, we have the link or the knot, and we consider a epsilon neighborhood of the knot or the link, and the boundary of this epsilon neighborhood corresponds to this peripheral tori. And when we have a ideally triangulated hyperbolic three manifold, recall that if it comes from the complement of a knot or a link, because that the vertices that are not in the triangulation would correspond to the knot or the link. And then the epsilon neighborhood the boundary of this, the epsilon neighborhood corresponds to some triangles like this or this. These are called, denoted by, this is the vertex V, by L of V, the link of the vertex. And if we have several vertices glued by the isometries, then there is an identification of the, on the edges of the links. So we have, we can glue them like this by the isometries. And this is homomorphic to some peripheral torus. And this gives rise to a triangulation on the torus, these links on the of the vertices. So now what we can do, if for its consider what's called the holonomy representation of the fundamental group of the peripheral tori. This is a homomorphism from the fundamental group of the peripheral tori to C star, which is intrinsic, and it can be easily computed by the when we have a triangulation. And the way to compute it is, if we have here the link of the vertex, that is some peripheral tori triangulated something like this, maybe, okay. And we have a loop going around here. And the vertices have edge invariant like this. Then the holonomy of alpha is defined, well, corresponds to the product of this edge invariant to plus or minus one, according if the corresponding vertex is at left of the loop, left or at right. In this example, I have drawn here the holonomy of alpha would correspond to the 1 times 1 over z2 times 1 over z3, c3 times z4, and so on. Then by fixing a holonomy longitude pair on its peripheral tori, something like this. We can define the map which goes from the deformation space, the manifold with respect to the triangulation, to C star to the 2L, where L is the number of peripheral tori. That sends maps a deformation to the holonomy of the longitude and the meridian we have fixed. Longitudes and meridians in plural. So this is an intrinsic map, and it only depends on the longitude and meridian pair we have fixed. And the problem is that, the dimension of the image doesn't match what I would like to have, or we would like to have, and in order to have the right dimension, we have to consider Thurston's equation. If we denote the holonomy as the exponential of ui, and this one the vi, then we have the equation ui plus qi vi equal to pi i. And this equation has an x solution as long as pi and qi belong to R2 infinity, which can be identified with the Riemann sphere. These are called the generalized Thurston-Neumann coefficients. And what Thurston and Neumann-Zagier prove is the following theorem. Thurston and Neumann-Zagier. The map from the deformation space to a neighborhood of C to the L under this homeomorphism that sends a maps a deformation to the then generalized Thurston coefficient. Oops, it's not a G, not a Q, sorry. Is by holomorphism. And they prove this by means of the inverse function theorem. They just computed the Jacobian at the complete structure, and they saw that it was non-zero. And a consequence of this theorem that, well, that they proved is that by Mousteau and Prasad, the deformation are non-complete, and if we complete them, Thurston proved that in many of the cases we had a complete hyperbolic matrix. And then we can consider by completing these deformations sequences of complete manifolds that converge to the original one, and the volume is different at its element in the sequence and in the limit two. So, and this is a phenomenon that only happens in dimension three. So this is the end of part one. In the next part, we will consider how to apply these results to the non-orientable case. Thank you very much.